Nothing could have prepared me for the revolution she started in my life. 16 months later, her brother, Alex, joined the revolution. And gradually, the two of them would become the most important teachers of my life. I say gradually, but it didn't take very long. By the time Alex could speak, my view of the world had completely changed. Everything I believed, everything I knew to be true, being around them made me realize I was clueless about almost everything. The first thing they taught me about was love. I thought I knew what love was, believe me. I mean, I married their mother. That's love, right? It is love, of course. But believe me, romantic love makes up only a fraction of what you're able to feel with your heart. The truth is, nothing can compare to parental love. There's nothing like it. Nothing I've experienced, anyway. Because that kind of love is unconditional. It's selfless. In my case, it's miraculous. So that was my first shocker. I knew nothing about love. Candace and Alex taught me that the capacity of my heart was exponentially greater than what I thought it was. I had no idea that I was capable of loving without ego. I had no idea such a thing even existed. So far so good, right? No doubt. That first lesson was a blissful education. Being their father was the most fun I've ever had in my life. It was practically constant euphoria. They made everything fun. I had never experienced so much joy in my life. But the problem is, you can't have light without darkness. Because you need darkness to know what light is. And everything in the universe comes from one of two primary sources. All light comes from love, and all darkness comes from fear. Everything light you can think of, kindness, generosity, compassion, empathy, forgiveness, charity, mercy, all of it comes from love. And all darkness, racism, homophobia, xenophobia, bigotry, hatred, terrorism, war, corruption, conspiracy, all darkness comes from fear. And you can't have one without the other because they balance each other. You have to have both because fear teaches us about love and love teaches us about fear. It's like they're two sides of the same coin. So while my heart was expanding with love beyond anything I ever could have imagined or even dreamed of, I also started to feel simultaneously fear worse than any I'd ever known. When Candace was 3 years old, we were in a grocery store together. I was pushing the cart. We were having a blast, doing nothing as usual. She was sitting on a little bench, right? And we stopped in an aisle, and there was this old man. He came shuffling up to our cart. He was bent over, and he was tight and gnarled and just dark. Darkness in his heart, bitter, angry. You could see it as he walked up to her, right? And he was, since he was bent over and she was sitting in the cart, their heads were about on the same level. And so without knowing it, he was this far from her head. And she was staring at him, and I'm sure he could feel her staring at him, and he slowly turned to her. And she said, "Hi." He just growled. He just grumbled and turned away. I was dumbfounded. I couldn't believe anybody could be nose to nose with that little pumpkin and it wouldn't lighten his heart. And so I watched him walk away and I thought, what must he have been through? Like, how much pain do you have to go through so that your heart is so dark that it's impenetrable? And I realized, if something ever happened to one of my kids, that's what I would become. I would turn into a bitter, angry, mean old man. So it was around that time, I realized later, in hindsight, I had made this unconscious, implicit agreement with God. Here's the gist. God, you and I are in really good shape right now. We're doing really well. You have blessed me beyond my ability to express gratitude. I will never be able to thank you for the joy you brought into my life with these two people. And I will spend the rest of my life trying to pay that forward. But if you hurt one of them, if you take one of them away from me, then I will be your enemy. I will devote my life to blocking you, to convincing people you don't exist. I will dedicate my life to doing harm. How's that for darkness? I was convinced if anything ever happened to me, I knew if anything ever happened to one of those kids, I would spend the rest of my life in darkness. So, flash forward. It's a week before Alex's 8th birthday. We're in the basement of our house in Boston. It's one of those typical New England basements. It's unfinished. It's got a bare concrete floor and there's pipes hanging near the ceiling. I'm doing laundry and Alex is swinging from the pipes. We had one of those little mini trampolines. He would take a running start, jump on it, vault up to the pipes, grab one of the pipes, swing for a little bit, and drop down his feet. He'd done this 1,000 times before. But that morning was fateful. If you've ever been in a really terrible accident, you may believe, like I do, that time is not constant. It's relative, maybe even physical. So I looked up from the washing machine, and time and space stretched. As I watched, in slow motion, my worst fear play out in front of me like a movie. He bounced too high, so his feet were above his head, and he lost his grip. And he fell 8 feet onto his head. So imagine this is bare concrete. And imagine I have a coconut. And I drop that coconut from here onto the bare concrete. Can you imagine that sound? That's the sound his head made when he hit the ground. So I knew, this is it. This is the last day with my little boy. So the instant his head hit the ground, time accelerated again. I popped into emergency mode without thinking about it. I called 911. I kept him still in case it was a spinal injury. I covered him up to prevent a shock, calmed his sister down, called her mother. And I sat beside him and waited for the ambulance to arrive. All the while in the back of my mind thinking, this is it. My worst fear. Next thing I know, we're in the hospital, and Alex is lying on one of those metal gurneys. He's not conscious, but he's not unconscious either. He's kind of in that in-between place, you know, and he's just kind of quietly moaning. And I'm holding his hand and staring down at his beautiful face. My spiritual guide. I didn't think about what happened next. I didn't have a conscious thought. I was just holding his hand and staring down at him, and my mouth opened, and out came these words. God, if you take this boy away from me today, I am so grateful that you gave me 8 years with him. I'll let that sink in. I was on the precipice of my worst fear, and what I experienced was the greatest gratitude of my life. The exact opposite of what I expected. That was the day I became obsessed with fear. And I started teaching. And I spent the last 20 years trying to help people liberate themselves from their fears under the guise of teaching acting. So, here's the point of the story. This is what I want you to take away from it. Fear is what's keeping you from what you want. What's preventing you from fulfilling your potential as a human being is fear. And here's the best part. Most human fear is irrational. Which means that thing that's standing between you and what you want, that thing that's blocking your way from your fulfillment, it doesn't exist. You made it up in your mind. It's a lie. So, if you want to liberate yourself, if you want to fulfill your potential, figure out what it is you're most afraid of, and then run right at it. You'll never be the same again. I guarantee you that. Thank you.